Hello again. We're going to look in this lesson at another discretization technique, supervised discretization. Now you're probably thinking, why doesn't he just tell us the best method of discretization and get on with it instead of going into all of these different methods? And the answer is that there is no universally best method. It depends on the data. And what I'm trying to do in this course is to equip you to find out the best method for use with your data. Also, this class is about the filtered classifier, which is a slightly different classification methodology, which is useful more generally than just in discretization. So let's take a look. Discretization is about transforming numeric attributes to nominal, and supervised discretization is about taking the class into account when making those discretization decisions. So here's the situation in this diagram. We have numeric x attributes, values along the top, and then underneath the discretized versions, which we'll call Y. And there are two bins shown here, out of many probably, bins C and D. And it so happens that all of the instances for which the X attribute is in bin C have class 1, and all of the instances where the X attribute is in bin D has class 2, with just one exception. There's just one thing in bin C which has got class 2. So it might be a good idea to shift that boundary just a little bit downwards in the direction of the arrow, and then we'd find that this particular attribute, the discretized version of the attribute, had a precise correspondence with the class values of the instances. So there's a bit of motivation for why it might be useful to take the class values into account when making those discretization decisions. Supervised discretization. How do you do it? Well, the most common way is to use an entropy heuristic like the one that's pioneered by C4.5, which we call J48 in Weka. So I'm looking now at the numeric weather data and the temperature attribute, which ranges from 64 to 85, and underneath are the class values of the instances. So there's an instance with temperature equals 64, which has got a yes class. And there's two instances with temperature 72. One's got a no class and the other's got a yes class. And if we take the entropy of that boundary there, underneath the boundary are four yeses and one no's, and above the boundary are five yeses and four no's, and we can calculate the entropy as 0.934 bits. We talked about entropy when we talked about C4.5 in the previous class, and I'm not going to go over that again. So the heuristic then is to choose the split point with the smallest entropy, which corresponds to the largest information gain, and to continue recursively until some stopping criterion is met. So at the bottom, we've continued splitting and made five splitting decisions, creating six bins for our supervised discretization. Let's do this in Weka. So we're going to use the supervised discretization filter on the ionosphere data. We already know that J48 gets 91.5% accuracy on this data. So let's go now to Weka. And I've got the data loaded in here. I'm going to choose the supervised discretization filter, not the unsupervised one we looked at in the last lesson. And it's got some parameters. The most useful is make binary. We saw how useful that was in the activity that we've just done associated with the last lesson. But we'll leave it at false for the moment. And I'm going to then apply that discretization. And now we can see that A1, the first attribute, has been discretized into two bins, which is not surprising because, in fact, it was a binary attribute. The second attribute has been discretized into one bin, so that will not participate in the decision in any form. The third attribute has been discretized into four bins, the fourth into five bins, and so on. I think all of the attributes are discretized into somewhere between one and six bins. Now we can just go ahead and apply J48, but there's a problem here if we're using cross-validation, because if we were to apply J48 with cross-validation to this discretized data set, then the class values in the test sets have been used to help with the discretization decision. And that's cheating. You shouldn't use any information about the class values in the test set to help with the learning method. So I'm going to undo the effect of this filter. And this is quite a general problem. Actually, if I just come to my slide here, we use a filtered classifier, which is a meta classifier. We met a meta classifier in the last course when we looked at bagging. Now we're going to look at another meta classifier. So I'm going to choose the filtered classifier from the meta. And if I look at the more information, it tells us it's a class for running an arbitrary classifier on data that's been passed to an arbitrary filter. That's exactly what we want. The structure of the filter is based exclusively on the training data. That's exactly what we want. So it's got a few two parameters here, the classifier, which by default is J48, happens to be the one that we want, and a filter, which by default is the supervised discretization filter, which is also what we want. So we can just run this now, and that gives us 91.2% accuracy, which is quite good, nearly as good as on the original undiscretized attribute. We found before that setting the make binary option was quite productive, so I'm going to set that to true and run it again. And we get a very good result, 92.6% accuracy, which is better than what we got on the undiscretized version of the attribute. And the number of, how big is the tree here? The tree has got 17 nodes, so it's not too big. That's using the filtered classifier to avoid cheating, so that the test sets used within the cross-validation do not participate in choosing the discretization boundaries. Let's try cheating. We'll probably get a better result if we were to set make binary to true in the filter, filter the data, apply the filter, and then go back to classify and apply J48. This is cheating because we're using cross-validation, and the class values in the test set have been used to help get those discretization boundaries. And sure enough, cheating pays off, 94% accuracy. That is not representative of what we'd expect if we used this system on fresh data. Okay, so that's it. Supervised discretization is when you take the class into account when making discretization boundaries, which is often a good idea. It's important that the discretization is determined solely by the training set and not the test set. And to do this, when you're cross-validating, you can use the filtered classifier, which is designed for exactly this situation. And it's useful with other supervised filters as well. There's some stuff about supervised discretization in the course text, and the activity associated with this lesson will ask you to evaluate the effects of cheating. Can you get any benefit by cheating? What's it worth? So good luck with that, and we'll see you in the next lesson. Bye for now.